I'd like to introduce Armin, who's going to talk about using all these cores that we're getting, and is producing quite a challenge to our software. He is one of the cleverest people I know, so over to Armin.
Thank you. So I'm here to talk about PyPI STM, which is software transactional memory. And well, what it actually means is something that will become clear, I hope, during this talk. So it is a bit of metadata. It is an ongoing research project. It's done mostly by two people, me and Remy Meyer, who is at ETH in Zurich. It is a project that has been helped a lot by crowdfunding, so we got some almost $30,000 over the 3 years of the project. So thank you for everybody who did contribute. And it's a project that started at the EuroPython 2011 Lightning Talk. So maybe a few of you remember I was there and I presented in 5 minutes how it would work. So yes, this is the result of 3 years of 3 years later, basically. So first question, why is there a GIL, a global interpreter lock, when you run your Python code? Well, I mean, it came as a historical reason, but now it's really deeply into the language, basically, or the C Python implementation. Well, C Python started as a single thread program, and then, well, the easiest way to change a program to make it run on multiple threads is just put a lock around everything, right? You have one lock that is called the global interpreter lock, and it needs to be acquired in order to run any piece of code. So the result is that, yes, you can have multiple threads in Python, cool, but they are not being used for parallelism. You use them for concurrency. Whereas, I mean, the difference between these two terms really means that you can use the fact that you have several threads that will run independent pieces of code or do some external call or things like that, but they are not actually running in parallel. So this was really done because it was the easiest way to change the interpreter. And well, it's also very, very easy for reference counting or for all this kind of internal details where we don't have to care, basically. So this has positive and negative consequence. Positive consequence, well, it's simple for the implementer. But it also has some consequences that are visible for you, for the user of Python. This consequence is that some operations are atomic. For example, list.append or dictionary, setting an item into a dictionary or doing these kind of things. You know that even if you are running a multi-thread program, another thread that would also try to do an update to the same dictionary, for example, is not going to mess up the internal state of the dictionary, and that would lead to completely obscure crashes, etc. No, this does not occur in Python. Well, all variables are volatile, basically, is what I could say here. And if you don't know what volatile means, it's perfectly fine. Now, it has negative consequence, of course. The completely obvious one is that you don't have parallelism, actually. You cannot write a parallel program in Python. I mean, not one program in Python. Well, there is another consequence, that the global interpreter lock exists, and it's fundamental, basically, but it's not exposed to the application, which means that you get some of the benefits, like the atomicity of some basic operations, list or dictionary setting, of this kind of stuff, but you don't get, well, you don't get larger scale atomicity, or well, you still basically need locks even in your Python program. So you need locks and then all the hard parts of locks, like deadlocks and everything. So how do we remove the gil? Well, there are three approaches, I think. The first is called fine-grained locking, the second shared nothing, and the third one, which I'm going to present, is transactional memory. So a bit of contrast, what are these three approaches? Fine-grained locking is, well, we have this interpreter which has the gil, so let's kill the gil. And instead, we are going to put very fine-grained locks on each individual object, right? So this is a lot of work for the guy who is implementing Python. I mean, updating Python, basically. Well, and also if you are talking about C Python, then there are tons of nasty issues, like, for example, reference counting, etc. Because, well, now you can have several processes that will in parallel try to update the reference count of the same object. So what is, there must be atomic updates but atomic updates are slow on processors, etc. Well, there are tons and tons of issues. The point is that it's an approach that actually exists in Jython and Iron Python. They are doing it, basically, but they are benefiting. I mean, they, as in the Jython maintainers and Iron Python maintainers, are benefiting a lot from the fact that the JVM and the .NET platform has really good support for exactly that. For example, the JVM hotspot will happily do lock removal on any object that it can somehow prove did not escape the current thread. Mm-hmm. And even in the case where it cannot prove things, they are doing kind of crazy things, like they have five different cases. The first case I've checked very quickly, and then you go into slower and slower cases, etc. Well, basically they're doing crazy things, and it's fine. So it's fine, but well, you still need application level locking. It does not solve that, right? If you're writing a Python program, and if you're running it on top of Jython, let's say, well, you still need to carefully use threads and locks and everything in your Python program. So this is why there is a completely different approach that has some traction nowadays, because it can be used on C Python. It's just shared nothing. It's basically this approach is that if you want to run some piece of code in multiple cores on your machine, you just start several processes. And then the processes, well, you need to design your program in such a way that it's possible to exchange some amount of data that is not too much. Well, it is actually a model that some people think is a good idea, and I kind of agree. For there are usages for which it's a good idea. It gives a clean model on a multi-threaded, well, a multi-core program. You don't have the issue of locks. Well, the negative point is that, well, you have limitations on what kind of data you can exchange between processes. You have actually overhead for exchanging the data. And also, it's not compatible with an existing threaded application. Well, it's still a good model, but it's not a 100% solution, basically. So this is now what I'm talking about. This is, well, transactional memory is a way, well, it's a way to run the interpreter as if it had a GIL, global interpreter lock. So the main difference is that instead of blocking, so when you have several, when you have a lock that several threads acquire, it usually means that all threads will have to wait, and only one thread can proceed. But here, the difference is that with this kind of locks, you can still run all threads. But you do so in a way, well, you run all threads optimistically, and then, well, you need some bookkeeping to check what each thread really reads and writes. And then you, at some point, you need to check if they actually did something that conflicted or not. And the hope is that in the common case, you did not actually get a conflict. And in that case, and everything works fine, and you succeeded in running your multiple threads in parallel. And in the hopefully rarer case of a conflict, you need to cancel and restart one of the threads. So this is a very, very high-level view. I should mention that here I'm talking about STM, which is software transactional memory. There is actually HTM that exists as well. That's hardware transactional memory that's implemented on the Haswell CPUs, actually. So the latest generation of Intel processors has HTM. Well, you also have some hybrids that are some clever implementation of STM that use HTM internally for some things. Most of these three different solutions are still mostly research only because, well, STM so far has a huge overhead, like the checking, cross-checking of memory conflicts and so on, has typically at least 2 times, but more like 4 or 5 or 10 times slower on per core. Then you have HTM, hardware transactional memory, which is in theory great, but in practice far too limited. At least so far, I mean, in the current generation, it's too limited to support. I mean, we tried to write a PyPI HTM, but it gives the result that if you run a transaction for one bytecode, then you have a bit of chance that sometimes it's not too long. Mm-hmm. Okay, so that's why I'm still focusing mostly only on STM now, really the software part. So, so yes, here in this slide, I wrote easy in quote, right? So let me explain why it's easy and which part is actually easy. The easy part is to go inside PyPI and replace the GIL, because you just replace the place that call GIL acquire and GIL release by respectively start a transaction, stop a transaction. Easy. Now the hard part is to actually write it as a library, how you write all this STM and STM handling code. So, I mean, the point I'm making here is that if you actually think about it, if a GIL acquire and GIL release, that's also actually something that's not completely trivial, acquiring a lock. Acquiring a lock is done with a library that is, for example, on Linux, the pthread library. And the pthread library itself is also a bit crazy. I mean, a lock is, yes, okay, how to do a lock naively, yes, just one word, and I put zero for not locked and one for locked, yes, okay, naive. Yes, it works, but actually it's not how it's done at all, because it's possible to optimize it far more using clever techniques. So here I'm trying to make the same argument. It's easy to add correct calls to start and end a transaction in PyPy, but the hard part is to write the library. Okay, well, here I'm presenting PyPy STM, but just mentioning this library here, that is the hard part, could actually also be used in CPython, which would be great. Then we get CPython with multiple cores, cool. But well, there is one catch. It's what do you do about reference counting? That's the main catch. Well, there are solutions, but they are involved, hard, messy, etc. Okay. I have a nice diagram to show how it works. So the basic idea is that in this diagram I have two threads, and I want to run things, that's a blue box, horizontal blue box. And well, if I were running this code with a normal Python with a build, then we would get the diagrams with the boxes that, well, they cannot run in parallel, right? So they take more time in total. Here with STM, they actually run in parallel, but the point is that you are, each thread is running a bit independently by being very careful about what it changes. Well, mostly all its changes are kept local. So this is what is done on the first part of the box. Like here. And then at the end of each transaction, each box, we do it in a special phase that needs this time to be synchronized across all cores. We push all changes so that all cores will see it. So the effect that we get from the programmer is as if, well, in this case, as if we had three independent pieces that were running, and these pieces were running here. Here, and here only. So basically, the three pieces run after, well, serially. You have the first piece, the second piece, the third piece. And it just happens that the preparation to the commit of the transaction occurred before, and maybe did maybe a lot of work before. So it means that a model, well, when you think about how it works, it is still essentially a serialization. So you still have one thread, then another thread, then the first thread that can commit. So that means that can produce a result that you can see. So in this sense, it's exactly the same as the JIL. So a PyPy STM works, feels exactly like a regular PyPy with a JIL. You don't have any additional issue, in any additional races, conflicts, etc. Okay, small demo. Here I don't have on this laptop PyPy STM, so I will just go through the sources. This is an example using, I mean, it's an example of a demo that was posted on the in the comments of the latest blog post. So it's not from me, basically. If you have the, this is prime function and you want to compute how many of the numbers up to 5 million are prime, well, you do it like this. And then you, if you want to do the same thing on multiple processors, then, well, there are several ways. For example, you can use a multiprocessing module. Then it looks like this. Yes, I think we'll just switch to another tool. So this is using the multiprocessing module. So it's doing the same thing in, well, in ranges. So it's really using several processors. So this happens to work because this prime is simple enough. However, it's not actually doing the same thing because, well, because if somewhere in the pi prime.py file, if somewhere there were some global state or something like that, then it would not work the same way anymore because now you have, now you run two different processors. Okay, so, well, I cannot actually run them and show timings, but it's on the order, well, you have to believe me, this one runs about 6 seconds, typically, so it's 6.2 maybe. This one runs something like 5 seconds. I mean, there is an overhead, right? So it's not twice as fast. And then you can write a version using multiple threads. This is just bare bone threads. It's starting here, import thread at the bottom, starting two threads, and then every thread, well, you have a queue to communicate the ranges. And every thread reads from the same queue, so gets the next range to do. And if we run this on top of a regular PyPy, then it gives us something like 8 seconds. So it means like 6 seconds, but with a bit more because there is a bit of overhead. And if you run it on top of PyPy STM, then we get 4.8 seconds, which is the fastest I described so far, which is cool. Okay, now the... well, here I'm cheating a bit, basically, because, yes, this example runs faster with two cores already, which is great. However, the numbers, I mean, all numbers here have been carefully tweaked to show this, right? Like if you change a detail somewhere, then it's three times slower. But the point is that we are getting there. Okay, now what I just showed is, yes, you can use multiple threads, and it's cool, and it's faster. Good. However, the real point I'm trying to push forward in PyPy is not, well, it's not just that, yes, you can use threads on below in your maze of locks and debug them forever. The real point is that you can use threads and very coarse locking. You can have two transactions that run optimistically in parallel. I mean, here I've just shown you this diagram. So here is another time the exact same diagram. However, now every block is no longer just from gil acquire to gil release at the end. Now it's from acquire some lock that you define in your application up to release these logs that you define in your application. So you see, this, technically there is no difference, right? It's just one log. It's just another log. However, the difference here is that you can now start to think about your application as it's starting multiple threads. It's using just one log, this time an explicit log that you imported from the thread module, but just one. And everything it does in all threads, whenever it wants to do something, it acquires this log. Right? It's something that makes no sense at all, a priori. It's something that you wouldn't do in normal Python because, well, you, why use threads then? Okay? But the point is that you can do it and then it can optimistically try to parallelize PyPyStm. So it means that, well, the thing I'm pushing forward here, the kind of program that I could foresee could be done with PyPyStm is really, well, yes, it's still using threads and logs, but you put them in some corner of your program with just one log, and, well, you have completely coarse-grained locking, basically. Extremely. So, I mean, an example, here is an application that is traditionally not multi... I don't have it here. I have to wave my hands, sorry. Wave more my hands. So yes, this demo is about bottle web server. I mean, it could be Twisted, it could be Tornado, whatever. So it is a web server, which is traditionally not using threads, okay? It works like you get a request from an HTTP request, and you are processing it, and maybe you're doing some complicated computation, and then you're pushing the answer. So the point is that if you just take one of these frameworks, like Bottle, you add a thread pool on top of it. So every incoming request you ask the thread pool by pushing something in a queue, you ask the thread pool, now please process this request. So in that thread, you will actually process the request and send the answer back to the main thread with another queue, for example. Then if you do that, then it can actually run, well, PyPyStm can run this program on multiple cores in parallel. And the point is that each of these single pieces that run in the thread pool are run by acquiring one lock, one global lock. So it means that the different pieces appear to run one after the other. So it works just like you did not have a thread pool at all. But in this example, I mean, this is an example where it will clearly mostly be, I mean, most pieces will be able to run independently from each other. So yes, this is, in summary, what I'm trying to say is that the PyPyStm programming model, yes, it gives threads and locks that are fully compatible with the global interpreter lock, but it's, here I'm not saying, now everybody should use threads on logs. Here I'm saying, you should make or use a thread pool library and use only cross-grained locking, because that's enough for the PyPyStm. So yes, you have three different three different kind of applications that are immediate. You can have a multiprocessing like interface where you can use a pool of threads. I think there is actually in the multiprocessing a thread option instead of a process option actually, but that's a bit pointless because, well, that's not running things in parallel normally. Mm-hmm. But yes, the point is that here you could have a multiprocessing.thread that works, as I said, by acquiring one lock. You can extend a twisted tornado bottle, like I explained. You can also, well, this is maybe a bit further down the road, but it's always the same thing. Like if you have a stackless or greenlet or G-event system, so it's a system where you have coroutines, basically, but coroutines tend to do something independent from each other. So you can again do the same thing. This time you acquire and release the lock around the execution of one atomic piece of the coroutine, which means from one switch to the next, for example. Mm-hmm. So yes, the end result would be, again, something that works, that continues to work exactly the same way, as in you take your existing stackless application and it continues to work, but on multiple cores. Yes, this is the current status. Well, the basics work, the best case of 25% to 40% overhead, which is much better than originally planned. I mean, it's really good enough so that usually with just two threads, it's already faster. So this is the overhead of on running only one thread. Mm-hmm. Yes, well, everything I just said before about the application level locks working the same way as a global interpreter lock is actually wrong. But it should be true soon. Now we have a workaround with atomic thing that I won't explain. It's temporary. Mm-hmm. And yes, well, there are tons and tons and tons of things to improve. Mm-hmm. So yes. As a summary, this approach has potential to enable parallelism of CPU-bound multi-threaded programs, or, I mean, it can be used as a replacement of multiprocessing, or etc. It can also be used in applications that are not explicitly written for that, like if you have basically anything that could potentially be replaced by a call to multiprocessing.pool.map. Mm-hmm. And yes, so the benefit is you keep the locks coarse-grained. However, the issue is that you keep the locks coarse-grained. I mean, this is something that has actually other issues that we, as in me and my coworker, were not very clear about so far. Will this work very nicely, completely in any case? I don't think so, actually, because you have the issue of if you are running things that should be running parallel, but are actually not, because, for example, both pieces would increase some global counter. This is enough to make the pieces conflict. And then if they conflict, they are again serialized. So this is an example of systematic conflict. So it means that if you take your program and apply just what I said and expect it to go just n times faster, then it may actually not go n times faster at all. And the reason is probably because of systematic conflict. Okay? So it's something that we need that then we need tools to debug. We need a way to find where the conflicts are and figure out, oh, but here I'm incrementing this global counter, let's fix it in that way or this way. Well, there are debugging tools and profiling tools, etc. All this is not done, basically. And all this will very probably be very much needed. So here, if you want to compare this approach with the standard multi-threading approach, in a standard multi-threading approach, everything is fast, cool, but then things crash if you don't lock correctly. Here, at first, everything is slow, but works correctly. And then you can improve. You can improve by detecting the conflicts and etc. But everything still works correctly, as in works the same way as if you had only one thread. Which I think is a very good approach, basically, especially for languages like Python. Mm-hmm. Yes. Mm-hmm. Yes, the performance I mentioned. Yes. So it's not production ready. It's still alpha, getting there. So you can download at this URL the first release. It works only on Linux 64 for now. And yes, it's crowdfunding. Thank you.
Thank you, Armin. We've got time for a couple of questions before the next session. If you've got a question, will you go to one of the microphones? Thank you.
Oh. Hi. When you say coarse locking, how coarse or fine-grained can it be? For example, login library has a global lock internally. Does that mean that logging something once a second would already hit this performance penalty, or is it still okay? What is the length of the atomic block that where is the threshold, basically? Can't hear me?
The question is, what is the threshold for coarse locking? How long is it in time instructions?
Okay, so how long can a coarse locked transaction run? The point is that in the PyPyStm, I try to enable arbitrary long. There is no limit.
Okay, I'm saying, how short is too short?
Ah, well, if you really do it too short, then you will have the jill. The jill will be acquired for a longer time.
Where is so the limit?
The limit is not important for the programmer. The jill offers a lower bound, and the size in the jill is tweaked to get the best performance. It's tweaked to be long enough so that making it even shorter would introduce too much overhead.
Can you hear this?
No.
Okay, I'll come and ask and you can repeat them. So a couple of questions. The overhead, is it fixed or proportional? So if you're running just with the pure interpreter, is the overhead pretty much non-existent?
Or? Right, no, the overhead is, well, I can't tell so far because it's a bit like it's in development, but that how I foresee it is that the overhead should be like 25% everywhere.
So you're relying on the JIT to remove some of the overhead?
Yes, but no. I mean, yes, the JIT will remove some of the overhead, but then the baseline is also much shorter, so it's harder to improve. So it turns out to be somehow similar.
And the other question is, you said you need to remove refcounting.
Yes.
Why?
So why do I need to remove ref counting from C Python? Yeah. Yes, maybe, I think I will take the question offline because this is just ask for a more complex answer.
Can you please repeat the questions?
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Do I understand correctly that if two transactions don't pick, you roll back the second one and retry? And then what do you do with the actions that transaction did outside of Python? The things that you cannot control.
Yes, okay. So the question is how do you roll back transactions that actually had already side effects? The point is that a transaction should not have side effects. And that is actually that fits very nicely in the model of CPython, because if you are going to have side effect like write to a file, you read the deal. So here it means you end the previous transaction, and you do is actually writing outside transactions.
Ah, okay. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Can you hear me over here? I at the other microphone over here. In Haskell's STM, there are combinators such as a retry, where you can take this STM transaction and say, okay, I would like to do this from the beginning. Do you intend to expose something like that?
No.
Because this is more low
here,
level.
Here the real goal is to have STM internally and not expose it at all to the language.
Okay.
Christian set up for the next one.
Yes.
Thank you again, Armin.